Ambassador Beritiska, ladies and gentlemen, and all distinguished guests. Thank you very much for the opportunity to have present our Indonesian government missions to give introductory and wider understanding of what President Jokowi and the new government want to do in Indonesia right now. Ambassador Desker had been giving quite the introductions actually from what and we have done regarding the policies that we are at the moment, at current time is implement and try to do our best on carried out the missions and the visions of the new government to look more and to see more into the sea and the maritime potential of Indonesia. For 70 years almost, we always being told that Indonesia is an agricultural country, that we are land-based industry orientations. We forgot that two-thirds of our territorial is water, despite other also potential in sites, lake, rivers, and all around Indonesia. So basically, definitely more than two-thirds of our territorial are waters. Potential that we have Indonesia as the second longest coastline in the world, so 95,181 kilometers, marine area of 5.8 kilometers, which approximate territorial sea 3.1 kilometer, and then ZEA for 2.7 million kilometers. But current conditions, we are number third for fisheries export in ASEAN, and revenue contributions only 227 billion. Utilization of processing plant, which is average of 56, but exploitations of fish resource that have reached critical point in several fishing grounds. The numbers of potential in the current condition is so much of contradictions. This is a heavy task, and almost to see is an impossible task to accomplish, to make it in line that the second largest coastal line in the world. We have to make it at least number one in ASEAN, because we at the moment still number third in ASEAN. As what Ambassador mentions, I was running a fisheries company from 1982 until current time, and also aviation in the last 10 years, giving me a lot of opportunity to see more of Indonesia, to see more of the maritime business, to see more of many parts of Indonesia. Susi Air with 50 aircraft and 215 routes flying all around from commuter area to primary city or secondary city, giving me a lot of opportunity to know Papua, Kalimantan, Sulawesi, as well as Sumatra. I probably know more Papua than most Papuanese. I knew more Kalimantan than most Kalimantan people, because of the old flights are basically flying from commuter to secondary city or between secondary city. And one of the work also we do surveillance and LIDAR mapping for government job also, as well as foreign government and corporations. With all those experience I have, I did have worry to actually taking the offer from the president. But I did see many things that I think, and experience also quite a lot to contribute to the country, if I can. So, thinking of both sides, I finally come to the point I will take this offer from the president and come to know what so far we have done in the fisheries ministerial. The missions and the visions of the government to put the future of our nations into the oceans. That's a very ambitious, very big missions, but actually very logic and very rational missions. As what we mentioned before, we are two-thirds are actually sea. And then as everybody had been calculating and analyzing about what potential can be coming from the Indonesian sea territorial are incredible. The last FAO number was mentioning about $15 billion at least from fisheries that can be reached. So to strive and to restore Indonesia as maritime country, seas and strait and bay has to be our future. And we had been turning so far, as what President Jokowi said, so long, too long, that we never see the sea as our front yard. We always see it as our backyard. We never see what had happened in our sea for many, many years. There are many things had happened in the sea that we don't know and we don't want to know. Or we pretend not to know. So I have seen here the three keywords are very important. So our missions for KKP is first to have our sovereignty in our sea territory, which is very important. Without sovereignty, we will not have any independence and freedom to even decide what and how, where, and what that we want to do. So when, how, where, that's very important to decide. And that's for that we need the sovereignty. And it's been for many, many years Indonesian waters had been happened so many illegal fishing that taking away almost whole of Indonesian potential of fisheries. In the last 10 years, from 2003 to 2013, we also noted that there are at least 800,000 fishermen households gone from our numbers, from before 1.6 million household fisheries and becoming only 800,000. On the same time, 115 exporters of seafood are also gone from our portfolio, which is at least $4 billion are gone from the business of Indonesian export. Why that's happened? Because there is no more fish. There is no fish coming to the shore anymore. Fishing has become a bad option. Not interesting job to get for everyone in Indonesia because of lack of fish. That is the irony of the size of the water territorial and the potential that we so far heard about, but fishermen are hardly get even one fish when they're fishing in the shore. There's nothing more, almost. And related to the plan of the president to put the future on the nation's livelihood, it means also sustainability has to be in place. There's so much way of fishing method that Indonesians are doing are not friendly environment. We can't blame this on them just by what's happened. The illegal fishing had been taking away all the most of the fisheries resources. They destroyed all our reefs. They destroyed all everything that can be our future resources of the sea. Most of those thousands of vessels are sized more than 200, 300, even 1,000 gross tonnage. They are using 50 to 100 kilometers of trawler's net. It's a destructive and an incredible, destructions are happening to our sea. So for those two, we imposed one moratorium for all foreign fishing vessels on the meanings and on the intention to eradicate illegal fishing. And we expect after sovereignty and sustainability is in place, we can expect prosperity can be achieved. Sovereignty, we start with the moratorium to fight and to eradicate UU fishing. Is basically enforcing our regulations, number 45, year 2009, which we have rights to sink the vessels when we size them catching illegally fishing in our waters. And we audited all Indonesian fishing vessels that have Indonesian license from ex-foreign neighboring country, numbers of 1,132, but in fact out there are 10 times or even 15 times more the vessels. I was starting realizing that the tasks are very huge and very sounds impossible to achieve, but I have to start from somewhere. So I was inviting 6 ambassadors from our neighboring country, requesting assistance that Indonesia has strong ambitions for building up the maritime businesses to become the new future for Indonesia. We realizing that so many problems and we need all assistance that necessary coming from all our neighboring. So all ambassadors agreed finally after long lunch for almost 5 hours from Vietnam, from Thailand, from Philippines, from Malaysia, also from China. We all agreed that illegal fishing is not only Indonesian enemy, but also global enemy. Malaysia has the same problem with illegal fishing coming from outside, as well as Philippines. So all these become one commitment that illegal fishing has to be eradicated in our waters. And we also informed that we will enforce our regulation number 45, 2009. And then seeing also that transshipment was becoming one of the reasons that illegal fishing is happening, so we decide to also ban the transshipment, which is, had been so long, for almost 10 years, basically make all our harbor quiet. All our port, no activity in the east part of Indonesia or in the west part of Indonesia, because people can transship anything in the sea. They fish, they process, they put it into mothership and gone. We never see anything. All what the people see in the island is the strong lights in the night, a floating city out there. Nothing is coming to the shore, nothing is coming to the port. We never see the numbers. We never see the fish. So that's the second regulation that we enforce is the banning transshipment. Now the governor of Ambon come to me, Ibu Susi, now we are busy with the activity of the vessel that you are sizes, but before it was very quiet. So this is a quite successful eradicating policy that we had, and we finally also come to several findings. This is an incredible, actually crimes had happening, not only fish that is stolen, but also our fuel had been massively used by all this activity. One of the day, Minister of Energy mentioned to me that actually 36% now diesel consumption are less than we used to have. That's an incredible number, billions of dollars that we are saving. So these vessels not only stealing our fish, but also using our fuel. The picture in the movie or in the TV or in the newspaper that once a while Indonesian Iceland's people are queuing for only 10 liters of fuel are not happening anymore. We had enough fuel. And also one of the policy that we are enforcing is that we do not subsidize anymore for vessel above 30 gross tonnage. Why we did that? Because we also have a finding that this 30 gross tonnage vessel are mostly not fishermen vessel, but the people who are trading the fuel in the sea. So they go not fishing, but they go selling the fuel. So all those doubling and tripling loss of the country have been massively happening for many, many years. To tackle this, only one national consensus can be happen. The policy, of course, attracts some protests, some unhappy feelings, but we try to explain. When you are in a situation on desperation, realizing your patrol, Coast Guard, Navy, and Army, and police, Marine Police, and our own Marine Affairs ministerial patrols are also not enough, not strong enough to eradicate all in the real physical world. The deterrent effect, it has to be in place. And we all agree that we have to do it. Finally, the national consensus has happened, and we all agree, that the NE agree, the police agree, and the KKP, the Ministerial of Marine Affairs, lead the team, and we start to eradicate the illegal fishing. Some cases are coming more even further, deeper. The human trafficking is happening, the drug smuggling is happening, it's all on the vehicle of illegal fishing. 80% of the drugs smuggling are using the line of illegal fishing, as well as human trafficking. Through Australia or through New Zealand, they're all coming with the illegal fishing boats. So it's the crimes that related illegal fishing we find out is actually much, much more. And the only thing to stop this is by giving the deterrent effect, sinking the boat and exposing it into the media. Of course, there are few people concerned about the pollution and this and that, but that's, we can explain, we don't fuel the boat. So we don't also really blowing it up. So actually just the makeup for the picture that it looks really a blown up boat, so, but actually not. So the boat mostly are sink in one piece, or the most destructive maybe two pieces, they become a new home for the fish. And I think that's the right way. So for all what this happened, finally, our sea are more quiet now. 15,000 or can be more, no more fishing in our territorial. But there are still few of them. And they mostly stay in the border, and they come and fish and swinging between borderline. And sovereignty, the fight to eradicate illegal fishing, is also giving us a new perspective that we are what we want to compliance more into the world demand of traceability and an appropriate product that is accepted by the market. And for this, Indonesia continue to comply with all what the world market are necessary need. The quality, the quantity is keeping the sustainable capacity of the fisheries. The human trafficking in Indonesia right now case are already in progress of investigation by the police, and few are already brought to the court. And several policies regarding sustainability also in place, and for this we will need an assistance and a coordination and a cooperation from all country that become destination of all our export. We are starting to measure the lobster and the crab that allowing to be catch. Realizing the potential of lobster which we had before from 6,000 tons and down to 300 tons only, we see an incredible depleting of sources had been happened. We learn from the way the fishermen are fishing and the way that the market is requesting. We have to put the measures on the regulations to keep and to make sure that the sources are keep sustained and there forever. So we are banning to export lobster below 200 grams. But in fact right now is a lot the juvenile of lobster, numbers of millions are exporting illegally to Vietnam, which we want to stop this because otherwise Indonesia will have no lobster anymore. So the export are starting with a juvenile of 10 grams. And every year, almost 8 million to 20 million juvenile had been exporting to Vietnam. And we want to stop this. If we want to continue that the lobster from Indonesia will stay sustained. Of course, we invite any country to invest in Indonesia in aquaculture or processing plant or aquaculture in freshwater or seawater, or also to grow the lobster in Indonesia, but not by exporting the juvenile out of Indonesia, because otherwise Indonesia will have no more lobster, as well as the crab. In the old days, Kalimantan export more than 15 to 20 tons. Now, the numbers of 5 tons is a lot already. So that means the depleting of more than 75%. Learning from what we had and see also in Australia, where conservation actually only increased the productivity, we want to do the same with our sources. The destructive of fishing, the destructive of harvesting any fisheries product, it has to stop. And we work on it very hard, and we know that this will bring some consequences into difficult transition time, but we want to do it. Otherwise, the future of the nation are not be achieved. Prosperity guaranteeing the livelihood of our stakeholders. We also, as what President Jokowi means to have a strong domestic orientation, is not that we want or we don't want the foreign investor to come, but we would like the investment are in the more processing plant, aquaculture, not on fishing. So this is also will be our task to change the regulation which we had, where at the moment foreign investment could not own more than 40% for processing and food technology in Indonesian businesses. We are planning to increase even up to 100% foreign own for processing plant and food productions in Indonesia. But for fishing, we will close it for foreign fishing vessel. So for fishing only will be Indonesians, but for technology, processing, and market and auctions, that will be allowed to run by foreign company. So it's a homework for us to do. Other than that, we are also committed to utilize our resources, targeted beneficiaries and stakeholders, such fishermen, fish farmers, processors and exporters. We are also planning to revitalize the aquaculture, freshwater or seawater, as well as the seaweed aquaculture, which is at the moment we had 1 million tons of productivity every year. And still at the moment 90% are export raw material. So this is also an opportunity for neighboring country to invest, to process the seaweed to become chips or karagin in Indonesia. And we are expanding this year for another 100 million investment into the farming of the seaweed. So that will be increased for at least 30 to 40% capacity of seaweed production in Indonesia. As well as the salt businesses, also we want to enable the local farmer for producing salt to become a worldwide quality and enough for the country needs. And we still need at least 2 million tons every year. That's also an open opportunity for any foreign investment to have farming for the salt. We also plan to build integrated small island development, which we will place in 15 islands this year. So we're expecting that in 2016 we'll start the running the productions, and also marine and fisheries technopark. And also we would like to do more into productions in the country for the feed for the aquaculture. 70% right now the corn feed for the aquaculture are still imported. With the exchange rate that getting higher and higher, it will be more difficult for Indonesian farmer to continue their productions. One thing from all what we have done so far, fisheries grow in quarter one are quite amazing. So we had grow an incredible of 2015 quarter was 8.64, which is double than most other sector that growth. It's an anomaly happened that while we shut down all the big fishing vessels, the local fishermen get the most beneficials. All the little boat are catching now the big tuna. Tuna that before they only knows the name and never see the fish, neither catching it. Now many local fishermen, they get 100 kg tuna only by small 2 meters boat. And people are happier now, the fishermen, and many companies that we had met before also planning to go back to the businesses after all. So one thing, the strong intention for Indonesia to do into the domestic orientation is not that we do not want foreign to come and invest. But we do need and we do have to appropriate remanaging back. We cannot anymore strong and have resilience on basic needs if we not allowed to have our domestic orientations. We invite foreign investment to come and jump and do work together, do business with us together. But yes, we do have to stop the fishing by foreigners. because that, I think, a part that Indonesian fishermen still can do. So foreign investment can do the processing plant, the cold storage, the fish market, and all export that can be done by the foreign investment. It's also for security and stability of the third democracy, the third biggest democracy nations in the world. If everything is not possible for a minimum of livelihood can be achieved by the government for its people, the security and the stability of the politics is also will be hard to achieve. And I think Singapore is agree with this. Poverty that had been happened in the last few years, we see in neighboring of us, the Rohingya, the immigrants, the slavery, the human trafficking. That's a part that we cannot just keeping it away from our eyes. Something that we should care and think. A country with no resilience of the basic needs will have such a problem. Indonesia with 250 million of people, we need to strengthen our domestic orientation for a basic needs, which we can work and invite every foreign investment to come to do the business together with us. 250 million are big numbers, and it's too risky to be unstable, and it's too risky to be on deepening poverty. So we have to keep this as a domestic priority to have rice appropriately self-sufficient, as well as fisheries, because that two are very important needs of the livelihood for the people. So, as sometimes I'm having a joke that I don't think the instability can be happening in Indonesia. But when it's happened, Singapore will be the last country who wants to see it, because it will be too much of an immigrant. If it's coming to Singapore, 50 million of them, 20%, that's too many for this country. So, in many ways, we do need to help Singapore. I know you are still our biggest foreign investment in the country. And I hope the policy and what we enforce is not a threat, or is not feeling as something disturbing the comfort of the foreign investment in Indonesia. So we do want to work together more. And we expect you to invest more as keeping the biggest in foreign investment in the country. And we do believe with what you achieve, we can also learn from Singapore. Indonesia is an island country, very big, very many islands. I remember in one of the day I was driving on a taxi from my hotel to a hospital. And one of the taxi driver was telling to me, Madam, I think Indonesia should make a country as small as Singapore, so easy to take care. So I said, what do you mean? Yeah, I mean, maybe you have to make 200 countries, something like that. Oh, I said, that will be not easy. So we won't finish fighting, then we will never build a country. So we have to keep our country together, and the ocean is the... is the united the island to become one country. And as an island people, it's very tough to have a way of thinking as a continent. We have to change our Icelander way of thinking to become a continent way of thinking. Look many things in a big perspective. Like a Singapore, as even small island, but you are part of the big continent. So we have to learn a lot, and we see this can be much more better future for Indonesia and Singapore to work together and ensuring that economy between two countries is only can be stronger and not getting less. So thank you very much.